we are switching to the dynamic fracture in carbon fiber composite materials. So for those of you who were not here in the first session of this symposium, this is a kind of the second presentation. The first one was dedicated to the ballistic impact with different types of the projectile. And so if you were there, I must apologize that some of the slides with motivations, they're obviously more or less the same, but I will repeat them. These results are based on collaboration between the University of Rhode Island, the group of Professor Aaron Shukla, and my group at Loughborough University in the United Kingdom. So this is obviously an idea, so just some teasers of the slides, and which I will give an explanation later on. And the major contents of my presentation, we will look predominantly at the experiment and the damage analysis, and because these are two parts of the work which were performed respectively in States and in my lab. So generally, there is no need to explain why composites, especially these type of the composites, are popular nowadays. They are being broadly used in different types of the applications, defense, aerospace, energy, and now going into automotive. And in contrast to the traditional or more traditional materials, the obvious heterogeneity of the microstructure results in multiple modes of damage. And when we superimpose dynamic loading on all these, the complex scenarios of the spatial temporal evolution of damage in different types of the damage results in a non-trivial scenarios of the material's behavior. It's very tricky to study these materials, and I hope that my lecture will demonstrate to you some of these types of the results. Now, the question, why specifically suggest now air blast and suggest why not projectiles? So clearly, interestingly, the blast seems to be a more trivial type of the loading in a sense. So just one reason that the load is applied over the same area, so that's why it's more of a plane type of the excitation. Another part is that there is no direct interaction between the parts of the, so just of the projectile, or the projectile itself, and the loading system. So this is the general idea about the experimental setup. So we have an air gun, and when the diaphragm is being pressed, then we have the airway propagated, and it is being just applied to the loaded type of the specimen. So generally, here are some parameters of the system which was used there. We have loading area of around such as 75 millimeters in diameter. And importantly, so just to understand, because we have this discussion in the previous lecture as well, that this is not a very traditional type of the support. We have a support here which will result in a 3-point bending like type of the excitation. In many cases, and we've done the experiments as well, where the specimen is being fixed around the all the edges of this. So these are the parameters of this material, and we are using the cameras which provide us with the digital image correlation capabilities to look at the out-of-plane displacement and the character of the deformation of the loaded system. So the material that we are being used, this is the carbon fabric reinforced composite material. It suggests it have two surface plies, such as the fibers are the same of the same family, and we have inside sandwich another 8 plies, which will make the total thickness of the composite material of 5.6 millimeters. So, because this is a fabric, it has a practically symmetric layout, so there is no difference along these two directions of the load. We were looking at three different types of the loads. which we can suggest consider as the high load suggest, and then we were looking at the low load and something in between, which is mid load. So these are the parameters, and these are the respective related reflected amplitudes of the related waves. And wave speeds were in the area between 650 to 950 meters per second. So before we were performing the air blast on the specimens, we performed this without a specimen, simply to measure the time of the evolution of the pressure this time, as you can see here, corresponding to these three times, and the fourth one was just also done when we have the maximum pressure corresponding to the failure of the entire specimen. So you can look here at the image. So you can see generally this is, as I mentioned, practically 3-point bending type of the loading, and we see quite a lot of the damage at the exit side, where there is just, as we know from the simple notions of bending, we have the material in the tensile stress, so there is the very dangerous type of the fiber fracture, which results in a significant loss of the load-bearing capacity of the material. And here are the snapshots, which demonstrates just the series of the effects, just of the events during the entire time when the pressure affects the loaded specimen. So here, just we are looking at these videos. They gives you the possibility to observe the behavior of the two main lines. One line which is going through the center and which is vertical, and another which is horizontal. So just practically one is going just outside of the screen, and another is just in the plane of the specimen, but in the middle of it. So I can show to you with this knowledge once more. So you can see that even with this relatively simple type of the loading, which would be quasi-static, quite a controlled one, dynamics introduces a significant amount of rather non-predictable type of behavior. And you can see more details, for instance, here. So just when we look at different positions for the same sample, and you can see here, for instance, the difference between the horizontal axis, so just in the center and at the edge, and you can immediately understand that though we are trying to do everything in a pretty symmetric way, so achieving the full level of symmetry is practically impossible. So, yeah, this was just now the analysis of the out-of-place displacement using the digital image correlation with the time. So, generally, as you can see, that the major results are more or less straightforward. The higher is the load, the larger is the deflection, as you would expect. If you will look at the reverberation of the plate after the first major cycle, you would see that the response is changing, and the reason for this is that the local damage inside the plate affects the global stiffness, so just there is a deterioration of the properties of this material. And obviously you can see that the failure curve suggests it is not going anywhere, it stops here because it's the specimen failed, but there was an initial a fracture which just didn't cause the total rupture of the specimen, followed by the final rupture. And so just interestingly now, but this is the results of the data acquisition, you can see that practically we have here the total displacement even less than in the non-failed specimen. Simply suggest the process was quicker than reaching the potential maximum load bearing capacity. Now, so this is another point, and I've done this in the previous presentation, it's simply how we can compare the same the behavior of different materials under different load, the same material under different loading conditions. We have suggested the standard way is to introduce the normalized behavior. So if now we will normalize all the out of place displacement by the maximum one, which is achieved in the first cycle of reverberation, you can see that, and this is given at the normalized times, so this is duration up to the time when you reach this maximum displacement, you can see that at 1/4 of this time, there is initial slight difference in the deflection of the materials. So just for instance, the largest one is for the high pressure. But when you look at the half time of this cycle, 3/4 of it, and up to the total deflection, then practically, though the behavior are rather different and the results are different in terms of the damage initiation, you can see quite a lot of commonality. So that's, in this sense, the system is rather robust and can be described using the relatively simple type of the models, at least in terms of its global behavior. Now we are going to just to the part which was done at Loughborough, so just when we were using the high-resolution micro-CT system to look at the internal damage in the material. And you can see here that so just before this, some analysis was performed on the visual observation. This is a typical type how it is being, so just the structures are being check when people are going around and looking for some size of the damage, and you can see that the system is pretty, so just doesn't show any significant size of the damage up to a very significant, so just pretty close to the case of the failure. Obviously, post failure or in the critical failure behavior, there is just all the signs the system is fully fractured as a result. But before this, it's quite a reasonable type of behavior. But it is not fully true when you are looking inside of the material. And you can see here, for instance, that already if we are now looking from the top of this material, then and we are digitally removing the material, leaving only damage inside the specimen, you can see the cloud of damage which was in the case, which practically was not noticed from the surface of this material. And clearly, we have a significant cloud of the damage, and so just obviously the change in the symmetry due to the type of the support of the specimen. So here, there are some, so I'm aware that I must just, as a chair, so just to stop myself. So these are some of the, so just of the internal features when we do the digital cross-section of this damage analysis. And this is the final slide, which I want to demonstrate to you. We can see that in this case, and we observed that practically it was a suggested linear increase in the terms of the out-of-play displacement with the increase of the applied loading factor, and more non-linear, but significant increase in the damage cloud area, which is total in this. This data, together with what was presented for the projectile interaction, are now being used for the as a benchmark for the numerical simulation in order to develop the proper models of the dynamic damage in composite materials. Thank you very much for your attention.